Elegant lyrics for a colorful language all her own.
She had an extraordinary body command of the English language, images that were Arabic in their complications.
But behind the tough-as-nails exterior was a woman of surprising vulnerability, whose desire for love led to four failed marriages and family tragedy.
Despite her outward strength, I think that she really was underneath a very vulnerable person. She didn't allow herself to show that.
There was nothing subdued about Ethel Merman. She dominated the stage and transformed the musical theater. Today, it's hard to explain what explosive power she had. You almost had to see her in action on stage to get the full impact. She knocked me for a loop when I was just a kid in high school on a trip to New York City. She was performing on Broadway in Something for the Boys, and I had never seen anyone or anything like her. Even today, Ethel Merman elicits reactions that are anything but lukewarm. Composer Stephen Sondheim recently remarked that Ethel had a habit of upstaging the rest of the cast, adding that she sure knew her way around a stage and could perform the hell out of a show. She was both a force of nature and a complete natural. The great songwriter George Gershwin once offered Ethel a suggestion. He said, "Never take a singing lesson, it'll ruin you." Fortunately, she followed his advice.
By 1908, America was stepping with syncopated confidence into the 20th century. Theodore Roosevelt was president, and his trademark qualities of bluntness and brashness could also be found in a feisty American born on January 16th, 1908, in Astoria, Queens. Her name was Ethel Agnes Zimmerman. Ethel was the pride of her loving parents, Edward and Agnes. The Lutheran family lived modestly in the home of Agnes's mother, a home Edward left each weekday to work in Manhattan as an accountant.
She had a very happy childhood. Papa was really, really proud of her as a child. He doted on her. Her mother, Agnes, was she was a more strict person.
Though her parents were loving, the only child was terrified of being alone and often cried herself to sleep. But at an early age, Ethel realized she could attract the attention of family and friends whenever she used her amazingly strong voice to sing.
From the day Ethel was born, singing for her was like falling off a log. It was just so natural. Her father would play the piano, and she had a ball.
By the ripe old age of 9, Ethel was determined she would become a star, like the one she glimpsed outside the Astoria movie studio, only 2 blocks from her home. Her ambition was also fueled with visits to Broadway's Palace Theater, where Ethel was captivated by comedian Fanny Brice and saucy torch singer Sophie Tucker. In 1917, the confident 9-year-old was taken by her parents to Camp Mills, New York, to sing for soldiers, soon to leave for Europe and the Great War. As the child who had never had a singing lesson belted out song after song, the astonished doughboys cheered.
They couldn't believe that this big voice was coming out of this little kid. I think it gave her a great vision of the possibilities, you know, of what she could do with that voice she had.
But as Ethel entered high school, the outgoing teenager was urged by her practical mother to become a teacher. Torn between obedience and her ambition to be a famous singer, Ethel compromised for the time by taking stenography lessons. She proved an outstanding pupil, and after high school, Ethel eagerly took on adult responsibilities with a secretarial job in Long Island. But whenever her girl-chasing boss left the office, she aggressively pursued her real goal, hunting for singing jobs in Manhattan. She also decided to drop one syllable from her name.
She didn't want to hurt her dad too much, so she went from Zimmerman to Merman. And as she explained it to her dad, if you put Zimmerman up in lights, people walking underneath would just die of, you know, the heat stroke.
How much do I love you? I'll
Ethel soon found work at the hot Manhattan speakeasy Little Russia, singing tunes till 3 a.m. before staggering at dawn to her day job. But her schedule paid off the night her personality and lung power bowled over a top talent agent named Lou Irwin. He made 20-year-old Ethel his newest client and sent the now ex-secretary on a series of hit singing engagements across New York.
How far would I travel to be?
One night, her talent caught the ear of Vinton Friedley, producer of one of 1930's most anticipated musicals, George and Ira Gershwin's Girl Crazy. To Ethel's delight, Friedley instructed her to appear at the elegant penthouse of George Gershwin himself for an audition.
She went up, you know, kind of full of trepidation, maybe the only time she ever felt any trepidation in her life. Gershwin was very nice to her, and he handed her I Got Rhythm, and she sang it. And he was so impressed, and he said, well, Miss Merman, if there's anything about this song that you'd like me to change, I'll be happy to do it. And she said, no, it's perfect, and got the job.
On October 14th, 1930, Girl Crazy premiered on Broadway. Ginger Rogers was the show's beautiful star, but the night belonged to Ethel Merman, whose knockout voice and presence transformed her from being an unknown into an overnight sensation.
I got rhythm, I got music, I got wine and apple, anything more. I got daisies in green pastures, I got wine and apple, anything more. Old man trouble, I don't mind him, you won't find him round my door. I got starlight, and I got sweet dreams, I got wine and apple, anything more. Who could ask for anything more?
Theatergoers were stunned by the power and the clarity of Merman's voice. At intermission, the excited Gershwin embraced Ethel and told her never to take a singing lesson.
Who could ask for anything more? Who could ask for anything more?
The next day, 22-year-old Ethel was amazed to find herself heralded in the press as the toast of Broadway. One critic raved, she can hold a note longer than the Chase Manhattan Bank. Offers poured in from nightclubs and even the New York office of Paramount Pictures, which showcased her in a series of one-reelers.
Listen, Senorita, I've got great news for you.
Oh, wait a minute, Kramer. I ain't no senorita, and I can take any news standing.
Phyllis. Yeah? We're sailing for Frisco tonight.
Okay, boys, I guess the party's on me. Listen, I always find the sun around, and here's the reason why. My troubles have grown, my thoughts are my own. I'm never alone with a sigh. So, be like me and look to all the known. Give yourself with feeling, it's fun to have the feeling reeling round. Be like me and look.
The lusty singer also reveled in the company of some of Manhattan's wealthiest bachelors, who were enchanted by her earthy, unpretentious attitude.
They had a lot of money, so they could, you know, show her a life that she was really unaccustomed to, but which she aspired to. She could be very kind of coy, kind of little girl, especially when she was flirting with men. She brought that out a lot.
After Girl Crazy, Ethel won raves and two more Broadway hits, George White's Scandals and Take a Chance. And by 1933, another dream seemed close to coming true when 25-year-old Ethel was summoned to Hollywood. The project was the Paramount movie musical We're Not Dressing, starring Bing Crosby. Ethel excitedly headed west, but her stay was a disappointing failure. Her looks were considered not beautiful enough for the movies, and Ethel's performing style was deemed too exaggerated. As a result, her minor role shrank more when her only solo number was cut.
She filled the screen too much. She was too big for it. I think the camera wants to be able to come in and it could not come into her. It always had to be backing off.
Fortunately, her frustration with the movies would be lessened thanks to songwriter Cole Porter, who was about to give Ethel one of her most celebrated roles on Broadway.
You're watching Ethel Merman on Biography.
It's the fusion.
Heart has stopped. Your brain.
The first teaming of 26-year-old Ethel Merman and one of America's most sophisticated songwriters, Cole Porter. The Yale-educated millionaire composer and the earthy girl from Queens had little in common on the surface, but from the day they met, Porter adored the singer he dubbed the Divine Ethel.
I think he loved Ethel because you could understand every word she said. Lyric writer's delight.
Merman's rafter-shaking vocals and sass sealed her reputation as the queen of musical comedy. And Ethel was overjoyed when Paramount Pictures hired her to reprise the role on screen.
In olden days, a glimpse of stocking was looked on as something shocking. Now heaven knows anything goes.
Once again, she was joined by Paramount's top star, Bing Crosby.
You're the top.
You're just saying that.
You're the Swanee River. You're the top. You're a V8 flipper. You're the buds that grow when the winter snow drip thaws.
Oh,
you're the walls of China. You're Carolina.
Yeah,
you're Santa Claus.
Make more.
You're a knight in the streets of Cairo. You're a flight in an auto gyro. I'm the lazy hound that hangs around the shop.
Oh.
But a baby on the bottom, you're the top.
But to Ethel's irritation, the story was reworked to play up Crosby, and her starring stage role was whittled down to a supporting sidekick part. Disappointed, she returned to her true home, Broadway. In Cole Porter's Red Hot and Blue, she showed sharp comic timing alongside Jimmy Durante and Bob Hope.
Two things made Merman unique. One was the voice, the instrument, and the other was her humor. When you get a great singer, somebody who can just knock your brains out, it's very rare that they're also funny.
Jerry.
In 1937, a new door opened for 29-year-old Ethel.
Hit it, babe.
Ah!
What a pair of pipes.
A contract offer from 20th Century Fox, which she hoped might launch her at last in the movies. She was cast in one of Fox's biggest films of 1938, Alexander's Ragtime Band, starring Tyrone Power and Alice Faye. The music was by Irving Berlin, and his score gave Ethel her best moments on movie screens to date.
Without my walking stick, I'd go insane. Can't look my best, I'd feel undressed without my cane. The thing that makes me click on Lover's Lane. Would go for naught if I were caught without my cane. If I were caught without my walking stick, I would go insane. Can't go to town without my walking stick. Because it may rain. And I can't be outdoors when it pours without my cane.
But again, Ethel was mostly relegated to the sidelines as her character lost Tyrone Power to the more photogenic Alice Faye.
Jerry, let's get married.
You got a fever? You sound delirious.
No, I mean, no, tonight.
Oh, no, thanks. You really don't want to marry me. You're just trying to avoid the bachelor tax.
This world of ours is ever-changing.
Believe it or not, this song was cut, leaving Ethel to quip, "It's cold and lonely on the cutting room floor."
With every change, I'm right on the beat. Won't let the grass grow under my feet. I'm marching along with time. I'll be marching